Welcome to the third episode of the Life, Money, and Football podcast, a podcast built to improve all aspects of a professional football player's life. In this episode, I sat down with Rob Bolden, the money QB and founder of Bolden Wealth Management. Rob was the number two ranked dual threat quarterback coming out of high school in 2010. Rob went on to play at Penn State, where he was the first true freshman quarterback to start the opening game under Joe Paterno. He also played at LSU and Eastern Michigan during his college career. Rob went through several transitions during his time in college, and in this episode, he is extremely candid about how discussing how his search for opportunities outside of the one that might have been right in front of him probably hindered his ability to make it into the NFL. This led him to learn one of his biggest life lessons, which is you have to embrace adversity at the mountaintop, not just when you're at the base. I hope you enjoy my conversation with Rob and hearing about his journey. All right, so we're here with Rob Bolden, the money QB. Rob and I actually met not too long ago, only maybe 5-6 months ago in a mastermind group for financial advisors who have started their own firms and got to know each other through our mutual interests in football, both his career playing and me looking to serve them today after working in the NFL for some time. So Rob, just go ahead and introduce yourself to the group and welcome to the podcast.
Yeah, certainly appreciate it, man. Glad to be here. Name is Robert Bolden, like that's it, from Detroit, Michigan. Played football in college throughout high school. Very, very small career in the NFL. but went to Penn State, played at LSU, did a little bit of time at Eastern Michigan. I traveled quite a bit for school. Played quarterback, hence the money QB. That was my position. Got into financial planning after my career, which has been a huge blessing, something that I didn't even know that I loved at the time, but now being in it, man, I don't know what else I would want to do. But yeah, that's the synopsis of it. I'm super glad to be here and dig into this conversation.
Yeah, and you left off the biggest point, right, in that recently engaged starting that journey. So,
yeah.
So we won't forget that. But yeah, I'd love to go back. So obviously your journey has crossed many different paths across the country, highs and lows. So I'd like to start, you know, growing up in Michigan, talk about growing up, playing football, high school, just kind of go back to the beginning of it all for you.
Yeah, for sure. So my journey pretty much started in, I'll just say sports, because it wasn't even football. That wasn't my first love. I thought I loved something, but that didn't turn out to be true. I got into boxing. I spent probably a month in boxing just to get out of the house, stay out of trouble, kind of keep me busy. And my dad boxed in the military, so I'm like, I must have a gene. I'll be able to pick it up. Definitely not my thing. I don't like taking punches to the face and stuff like that, but I will somehow in some crazy way, like, get beat up on the football field. Somehow I think that's better. But yeah, I started in boxing. I did that for about a month. I did like the training regimen of it. I just didn't like it was a bit much. So I did that for a month and transitioned into football at the age of 12. And even prior to getting on the football field, me and my dad had a relationship where we would always be tossing the ball back and forth. He'd be, like, coaching me up and giving me pointers and tips and stuff. And we just kind of stumbled upon that I had a really strong arm and could throw the ball very far and all of these different talents. And one day, instead of boxing, it was like, it's a team literally right outside. Let's just stop by and see what happens. So we go there, and they have me do what I've been doing for the last few years, just talking, tossing the ball back and forth, and they're like, oh my God, who is this kid? They're like, all right, well, we know what position you're playing. And since 12, that's literally the only position that I played. So from there, going throughout the entire process, from literally to high school, being recruited and being blessed enough to have my college paid for and playing sports in the Big Ten, SEC, man, it's been a journey. I've learned a lot. And I always say, like, we go by the money QB just because I had to, like, quarterback, if you will, those situations just the same as everybody else has to quarterback them outside of the football field. So, yeah, man, that's kind of the synopsis of it all.
Yeah, and so, I mean, you maybe humbly glossed over, like, the recruiting process, right? You were the number two dual-threat quarterback in the country in your class. So, I mean, highly recruited coming out of high school. So talk about what that was like back then, because things have changed, but let's talk about what it was like for you back then.
Yeah, it's a process that was very meticulous, and I say that because, like, for me, it started, like, really early. I want to say right after my freshman year, I went to, you know, you do the camps, the off-season camps. You'll go to, like, college camps and bounce around and do a little bit of traveling. So me and my dad went up to Central Michigan for one camp. They had a one-day camp, and I just remember me and him going everywhere. They would have, like, there's a place here called Midwest Elite where they do off-season training and all kind of stuff. So I was at everything, and I remember this camp that I went to. It was for Central Michigan. And they had this one-day camp, and I just go and crush it. And if you know, like, if you go to these camps and they like you, like, even for, like, Central Michigan is a big school, but, like, a really big school, like the Big Ten schools and stuff like that, once that first offer comes in, it's like a slew of other ones that come afterward. So I hadn't heard anything from any colleges prior to going to that camp, but after I left, they offered me on the spot that day, and then after that, literally everything just went crazy. So with that, I ended up having offers from a lot of different schools. I pretty much could have went anywhere in the country, and I chose to go to Penn State, obviously, but I did talk to a lot of different coaches, and my dad was very instrumental in, like, just having those conversations and knowing what to say, what not to say, kind of just playing the game. So I would just kind of listen in on those conversations and see what he was doing and just talk about it after, like, okay, well, why did you do that? Or what are we thinking here? It was very, like I said, the word I used was meticulous. Yeah. So, yeah, that process was a lot of fun for me just to be able to travel. And I did a lot of the I wish I did more of, actually, the official visits. I was supposed to go to Oregon. It ended up getting canceled. I would have loved to just go there just so I could get a bunch of gear and stuff. But, but yeah, it was a great experience, man, to be able to meet all the coaches, be able to talk to a lot of the coaches. Like, coaches were coming to my high school, sitting down in person. And
so I could never get, like, Joe Paterno never got on the plane and came and did any of the recruiting, but we always had the representatives, which was super cool. And people would always get excited depending on who it was, especially, like, the locals. I'm from Michigan, so people love Michigan and love Michigan State, all of the coaches coming by and everything. So it was just a really cool experience. One I'm just happy that I had the chance to be a part of and just really have that to be able to tell the story of it, sitting here with you. So, yeah.
Yeah, and I mean, it sounds like your dad was instrumental. What do you think the experience would have been like without him?
That's a great question. Probably not as concise, I would say. He's militant. He's, like, very direct. He plays chess. Like, just thinking 10 steps ahead is just how he kind of does things. And me being at that age and not necessarily having, like, my mom necessarily doesn't have those same traits. Nobody really that I know at that time would have been able to kind of carry that. in the way that he did. So for that, I'm super grateful. Without him, I don't know, man. He made so many moves and sacrifices during that time to put me in that position. It would be very difficult to kind of speculate what would have happened without that help. I'd like to say I'd still be a baller. I'd still be able to play. But the foresight, the connections, the exposure, even his willingness to just drive to Tennessee on a Tuesday or whatever, it's like, you know, that was pivotal for my exposure. So I do owe a lot to him and what he was willing to give.
Yeah, because I mean, a lot of guys unfortunately don't have that support, right? Whether it's getting you the exposure you got in all those camps that he took you to, but it's also, to the point, sitting in the room or fielding the phone calls that you were probably bombarded by. To, you know,
literally bombarded.
Yeah, you know, come play here, we want you here, here's why you should be here. You know, so I think it's amazing that he was there for you to do that because, yeah, you know, even then, before NIL, of course, it was difficult. So along those lines, like, not only how helpful your dad was, but what do you think about what the guys are going through now with NIL and how that experience would have been if you were being recruited to today?
It's like night and day, I would have to say, only because when you really think about it, the pressure that comes with pre-NIL, just in general, being an athlete, having this kind of standard that you want as an athlete going into college, and then adding all of the pressures of family and friends and 100,000 people in the stands watch you, that's a lot to deal with. There's something there, right? Like, that's a lot to deal with on its own. But when you add NIL, let's not even go there yet. The goal for which you were going into college was to try and just dominate it well enough to where you'd have the opportunity to be able to continue your career. I think by going into the NIL, it's awesome that the athletes are being paid. It's awesome that they're able to make money. But we have to also recognize that this kind of blurs the lines for a lot of athletes. The same hunger, the same drive, the same want to that we may have had in college may kind of subside when you're already making 100, 150, 500 grand per year. You're driving a Ferrari. Like, do you really need to go and further beat your body up?
Yeah.
Or are you perfectly content with playing your 3 years and just making as much as you can to be able to transition into some type of business? Because that's really the mindset that now I'm thinking about it as, where you have this 3 or 4 years to just really rack up as much money as you can and set the foundation of what your life is going to be. That's one theory of it, of the college student doing it the right way. But there's the other, probably more applicable scenario, where the athletes are still 18 coming into money and have no idea what to do with it. And I share this story all the time. I had this instance happen to me when I first got to Penn State, and I was dealing with a very small amount of money. And we got a Pell Grant. It's every semester you get $4,000 or $5,000, and you don't have to pay it back. You do whatever it is that you want to do with it, and it's yours. And I'm the money guy today, but at 18, I wasn't thinking about any of that. Like, I spent every dime. I was on trips back home. I was buying the clothes and doing all the crazy stuff that had nothing to do with anything. And all of that money is just gone now.
Yeah.
And that's just me at 18, just doing what I thought was best. Even having people in my ear telling me, like, hey, you should be investing, you should be saving, you should be doing all of these things. I knew it was the right thing to do, but I didn't do it. So when you take 5K a semester and take that to be 500, 300K, or whatever it may be, the problems just amplify. Yeah. Number one being, now you're not just like the star on campus who's still broke like everybody else. You're the target star on campus who everybody knows your pockets now. And first of all, like, I wouldn't want to be known as that person. Like, I don't want to go anywhere. I'm a target, dude. Like,
yeah.
It's crazy out here. That's one thing. And then also adding in that most of the athletes who are in that situation don't necessarily come from money.
Right.
So if they can't focus and, like, do what they need to do, they're going to have calls every 5 minutes asking for something or pitching this new business idea that's going nowhere. Like, it just takes a lot to be able to discern what's important at that time, because at a young age, with not having money, and then suddenly coming into money, I mean, I kind of put it in the same framework of, like, the lottery winners, 60% or 70% go broke. Like, it's not just the lottery, it's windfalls, it's period.
Yeah.
So however you get the money, it doesn't matter. But, like, you can give people money, but the wisdom to keep the money is a totally different conversation.
Yeah. And I also think this came up in one of the other episodes. Think about the time. I mean, I want to get to why you chose Penn State, but when you're at Penn State or LSU or Eastern Michigan, right, your daily schedule, if you think about that, when would you have even had time for NIL-related activities, right?
Not much at all. It's already a lot going on, and I think that's the biggest thing that I actually appreciate, but I hate it while I was in it. Only because from 7:30 a.m. to 10 o'clock at night, like, your day was broken down into hour by hour. So it is not a whole lot of time to really do a lot of that stuff. And things look different now because it's in the position that it is. Like, I'm sure somehow they accommodate it, especially when you're talking about that amount of money.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's definitely difficult, especially if you're trying to, like, now something is kind of going to have to fall.
Right.
And that typically may be grades, that may be, like, your focus to the football field. It's a lot to balance, especially for a kid who doesn't have the experience balancing a lot of these things. So it's very new. Just like today, it'll be a lot of stories of people who have gone through it, and some will get it right, some will get it wrong, but it'll be a lot of stories told
from
it, for sure.
Yeah, you know, 10 years from now, I'm still interviewing and people like yourself, I'm be interested to hear what those stories are. Because, yeah, there's already, you said it, and I want to get to, you know, selecting Penn State and obviously the beginning of your career there. I mean, the pressure is unbelievable to begin with, let alone whether it's the pressure you put on yourself to earn money for whatever reason you want to, or it's the pressure of, well, you know, I'm Rob Bolden, let's say you're being recruited today, or and you're looking at Bryce Young or the $6 million Tennessee man, right? It's like, well, the pressure of, well, I should be getting what he's getting if I'm being as highly recruited as he is. So, I mean, it's just more pressure on an 18-year-old kid. It's unbelievable. I think, you know, the stories that we'll hear in 10 years are going to be very interesting. We'll see where it ends up. But I do want to get – so – you could go anywhere in the country, right? Why Penn State?
Ah, man. So, coming from Michigan, I have to start, like, with Michigan. I could have went to Michigan. I could have went to Michigan State. I visited both schools. Spent time with the coaches. I did all of that. But I don't know specifically why I made the decision. Well, I sort of know why, but I can't definitively put my finger on why. I just had this urge to get out of state. I knew I didn't want to be in Michigan, but I didn't know where that place necessarily was for me. So for me, as I was going through the process, we started collecting a lot of information and building relationships with a lot of different coaches. And as we did that, we started weeding the list down. And I remember being really, really high on, I know Oregon was in the mix, Northwestern was in the mix, Penn State obviously was in the mix. I was looking at Vanderbilt being in the mix. And that's all that I can remember right now. But from those schools, we, my dad included, we started to just have conversations about what was real. And obviously, like, I think a lot of times now, and it's different now than it was back then, but, like, I knew, like, okay, where my mind was leaving St. Mary's is where I went in Orchard Lake, Michigan. Where my mind was at that point, I just knew, all right, we about to go through all of these schools, and we're going to see which school has just a favorable situation.
Yeah.
Like, I don't care if they're a senior. I don't care, like, where they are, if they play any of that. I'm just looking at, like, okay, where am I comfortable? Where do I feel like I can get in and do my thing and be comfortable with my team and my coaches? And then outside of that, like, my mindset is just wherever I go, I'm just going to decide and I'm going to win. Like, I just want to win and get on the field my first year. And after looking through all of the different schools and just kind of sorting them and vetting them, Penn State was just consistent, man. Like, when I told the story of coaches coming up and, like, just spending time and being with you and calling, they did that just a little bit more than everybody else. When I did my recruiting visit, I fit right in with the team. Everybody was, like, very welcoming. Everybody was helpful. And then the roster, even though they had at the time, Daryl Clark was the senior who was on his way out the door. They had Kevin Newsom, a guy who I forget what grade he was in at the time, but he was an upperclassman. And then there were they recruited a guy that was in my class who enrolled early. And then there were two other quarterbacks. And throughout this, I just knew the guy who came in early, he kind of had a head start. He knew the playbook. Yeah. He had time with the team. But even still, like, I was able to get there and everything that I kind of thought, it just happened. I really don't know the recipe or how it went down, but I just went there just focused, man. And it ended up being a great choice. I loved everything about it. And that whole process was just really, really cool and revealing with just seeing what was possible for whatever decision I made.
Yeah. So what would you say is, like, the number one piece of advice? We're about just over a month out from the first signing period, that you would give, you know, the young men trying to decide where they're going to go now?
Yeah, it's a lot to consider. I would just really focus on the relationships, because right now, especially from players and coaches, you know how easy it is to just get up and go. And I did this, and it's something that I have to deal with. Sometimes it's a good move, but more often than not, there's something that you have to deal with, like, internally, which is true for myself. I'm talking to myself right now. There's something that you have to deal with internally that you could probably still overcome in the space that you're in. So I would say, like, just really focus on those relationships. Like, that's the key to it all. And just be real with yourself. Like, don't think you gonna go there and just dominate when you know that's not what you what your work ethic says. Like, for me, I had it. I was blessed, man. Like, when I talk about my dad, he was crazy. Like, he literally would have us, like, running to practice. I'd practice. If I didn't win every sprint, I was running home. Like, he was that type guy.
Yeah.
So, like, I had that sort of advantage when I got to Penn. Like, I continued those things. And then over my career, I kind of lost touch. I stopped doing the things that got me in a position. So, like, you just really have to be real with yourself and just know, first of all, who you are. Second, like, what you will do and just stick to it. I don't think, like, you have to lie to you. If you have to lie to yourself, it's probably not the situation for you. So I would just say slow down and really dig into those relationships to get to know these coaches, to know who they are, and what their character says about where they are right now and their program. And that'll give you a lot of insight to be able to discern which way you should go.
And that's a life lesson, right? Like, look, me and you both are financial planners. We, for a living, help other people. And our entire careers are dependent on us building relationships with people. You know, and that's not just our industry, right? There's so many jobs that if you don't make it to the NFL, or even if you do and after the NFL, that so many careers are built off of relationships. So it's a very valuable lesson that, you know, it's 16 sometimes, 15 sometimes, you start to learn. So I think that's a great piece of advice is, you know, focus on who you feel is the most genuine and has a true interest in your success as a person, not just as a player. Yeah. I think that's great advice for kids, because we'll talk about your journey, right? You just never know how it's going to work out. And to your point today, you were sort of maybe very early on in the kind of transfer for opportunity era, right? Now it's all the time, to the point that now they've got to, you know, put restrictions around when are these transfer portals open. So I think that's a great piece of advice. But going back, you had this mindset. You go to Penn State and you become the first true freshman quarterback ever under Joe Paterno, and I think since like the early 1900s to start at Penn State. So, like, you talked about pressure. So talk about, you went in and you did what you wanted to do, but talk about what that was really like when it happened.
Oh, man. Where do I start? I just remember getting to Penn and having, like, I'm still this young, scrawny 18-year-old, just got on campus, don't really know what's happening. And here I am having to go in the locker room and tell 11 other men what to do. And it's just mind-blowing, man. Like, how I felt at that time was that, like, I knew I could because I had done it before, number one. But it was like a wake-up call. It's like, oh, this is – when I got to campus and I'm in the locker room, it's like, oh, this is real. Like, okay, it's you have to, like, do what you said now. And it was really surreal. A lot of that I did, especially when I was at that age, I didn't know half of the things that I know now. So I was a lot more reserved. I didn't have, like, a really big personality. I was kind of like the just kind of quiet leader. I would do everything that the leader was supposed to do, but I wouldn't vocalize it. So I didn't play with a whole lot of personality just because I was still trying to figure stuff out. And during that time, man, I just remember even the leadership role that I took over or took in, like, it was still received, like, even though it wasn't vocal.
Yeah.
And I started noticing that people on the offensive side of the ball started rocking with me. The people on the defensive side of the ball, they started liking me a little bit more just because, like, I was just consistent. Like, had the mindset of, all right, I'm going to show up. I come with humility. I don't know it all, but I'm willing to learn. I'm willing to stay. I'm willing to work.
Yeah.
And that went a long way. And throughout that, like I said, I didn't enroll early. I literally got on campus like maybe a month or so before the first game, which is absurd. But like, I just remember going through camp, going through this whole process, and then we were in a team meeting where they're supposed to like announce who's the starting quarterback. This is literally the day before the first game, and they're like, all right, we rolling with Rob. I'm like, oh. Like, okay, it's on now. Like, yeah, so with that, I played it cool. I didn't get all like excited. I'm like, okay, cool. But inside, I'm like, I gotta call my people.
Yeah.
So Penn State does this cool thing, where they'll take from the training facility before the game. They take like it's probably 4 or 5 different buses that they take from the training facility to the stadium, and they take the same route around campus before getting there. And the thing is, the starting quarterback of that game, whoever that person is always the first person off the bus. So that's what, like, signified it. Like, this trail that we go on,
yeah,
is lined up with fans. They're beating on the bus. And, like, my teammates behind me, like, yo, you good? And it's like, okay, now this is real, man. Like, beating on the bus, and literally I just remember it's like the real buses, doors open kind of like that, and they open and they're like, okay, Rob, go ahead. I just remember walking down, when my foot hit that ground, it was just like chaos, man. Just everybody just lined up, you're looking around like, oh my goodness.
Yeah.
And then my people are in the crowd. I dap my dad up, my mom, and we go straight into the locker room, and it's time. So it's just a lot happening during that time to really just take in and appreciate, and like those moments you'll never forget. There's a picture of it somewhere I have, where I'm like getting off the bus trying to like keep my composure. My face is just all crunched up.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, that first like off the bus feeling, man, it's surreal. It's crazy.
Yeah, I mean, this is 18 years old. Like you said, a month on campus, and boom, yeah, in front of 100,000 people, first person basically in forever to do what you did, and you know, in those first few games, you had some pretty tough opponents that you were,
yeah,
playing too. So talk about like,
put me right,
how it went, you know, and what that was like. And I know you mentioned this, obviously, that, you know, probably your whole career at Penn State didn't go the way you wanted it to. But so talk about kind of how things played out. And now looking back, you said there's things that, you know, you didn't know that you know today that maybe you should have worked through. Like, talk a little bit about, mm-hmm, that as you describe, you know, how things went at Penn State.
Yeah. So early in my career, like I said, I had been so prepared for moments that I really hadn't had to face a whole lot of adversity. Things just went the way that I planned for them to go. So out the gate, like, things were sweet. Like, my first game, I went crazy. Everything was great. Second game, we played Bama. Although we didn't win, like, I showed up for the game, performed well, did my thing. As the games went on, I ended up playing Minnesota, and we're at Minnesota, and this is the first time that I have like my first major injury. So like, I get a concussion, and this is the first time that I actually have to be like on the sideline during a game. So that, I knew that something had shifted in myself where I really didn't know how to deal with. And it I didn't address it the way that I know that I should have addressed it. I just kind of hoped that I would get back to that, but not. Sometimes you got to voice those things, like you have to talk through it and like, hey, coach, like this is where I am. This is where I'm trying to get back to. And I don't know how to, I need to bridge this gap. Like, how to, what's going on? So those conversations during that time weren't necessarily had. And like, after that first injury, there was literally just a battle, not with anybody else but myself, I could say, just because the confident, like Rob Bolden, who once was, now was a little bit shakier. He didn't have like the firm foundation. He had got his first bit of adversity, and sometimes he'd show up, but sometimes it was like, I don't know, like this kid doesn't look the same. So I would say that was a tough time for me, and I noticed that it was a shift in how I dealt with athletics, just because I just carried that from Penn State going down to LSU.
Yeah.
Like thinking that the school would be a resolution, it was something that I needed to resolve within myself to actually like make it work. And I know, without a shadow of a doubt, like, I remember my dad telling me, like, you have everything that you need to be successful. Like, just do it. But it wasn't necessarily just doing it. It was doing the mental work, not just the physical, to get myself in that space where I was comfortable performing. So that was a rough time, man. I had a lot of questions that I didn't really know how to ask. A lot of feelings and things that I was experiencing that I didn't know how to necessarily deal with.
Yeah.
And I carried it a lot throughout my career. And I'm grateful for that experience, man. Like, those times that I went through, I'm a believer. It says in the Bible that these times or trials and tribulations that you go through build character. And I know, like, for sure, those situations I can look back on and kind of see now, like, all right, if you went through that, or like you were able to figure that out and see it in the way that you see it now, like, you, what else is there? So yeah, it helped. It didn't feel good in the time, and it never does. But now looking back, I can see why like things play out the way that they play out. It worked out perfect in a very paradoxical way.
Yeah. And, you know, let me ask you a couple questions about that time. I mean, was it just because you didn't seek out the help, or was it because you didn't feel like the support was there? Like, was that something you felt like you could go to the coaches and talk to them about?
I think it was a little bit of both. Coaches were always open. I won't blame any of the coaches. They always had an open door policy. And if it ever felt as though it was closed, it was just because I wasn't taking advantage of it. So I would just put that totally on myself, knowing that like they were supportive. They wanted me to be on the field and gave me plenty of opportunities to be able to do that. However, it took a little bit of initiative from me that could have been upped in those situations to really dive in. And like, that's when I go back and take my own advice on what I said earlier about relationships. I was so focused on the game that like I wasn't leaning on people. I didn't know how to include people in an area that I was a little bit vulnerable or weaker. Yeah. And that ended up being a struggle. There literally is strength in being weak sometimes. You have to, like, bring them things to the forefront so that you can, you know, be triumphant and overcome those things. But that was a struggle. I just internalized it all and felt as though I just had to figure it out. Like, I'll figure it out.
Yeah.
And, you know, a month go by, a couple months go by, a year go by, and then your career is over. And you left with all of these questions that you have to figure out for what's next. So, yeah, man.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, I mean, knowing you now after all of that, right, in the environment we met in, this mastermind group, really the only reason we're in the group is because we're willing to be vulnerable about where we were and are with the businesses we're trying to create, right? I mean, I think both of us would agree, like, most of the biggest benefits we get from the group that we're a part of, right, is talking less about, you know, cases that we're working on with clients, but more about, like, us as people and starting a business, growing a business, trying to build relationships with people that are sometimes difficult to get in touch with. And so I can vouch that you have definitely learned that lesson, because I've seen that in the stage of life that I now know you in. So I agree. I think, you know, whether the experience went the way you wanted it to or not, it went the way it was meant to go for you to do what you're going to do for really the rest of your life and the majority of your life. So I think it's a great lesson. And you sort of alluded to it. I mean, the transfer to LSU and Eastern Michigan, it sounds like some of that was to try to make the correction and sort of battle through this, but talk a little bit more about your mindset as you made those changes.
Yeah. So at Penn, it's always difficult to make these transitions because I got to Penn State in 2010 and I stayed to 2012. And I didn't bring up, like, if you follow Penn State football, like, there was a huge scandal that we haven't mentioned, and I was in the middle of that. So that things, performance-wise, I was in that situation in what we just talked about, but you add all of that. Yeah. You add all of those things happening at the same time. That just kind of amplified the issue.
Yeah.
So I think for my transition from Penn, obviously, and what I discussed and needing to still kind of work through stuff, my situation at Penn was just not good with, like, this scandal happening. So I likely would have made a transition anyway.
Yeah.
But the transition would have had to come, or would have been better prepared for, with some of the work that I discussed. So it's always tough leaving one school to go to another school. Like, these were my guys, like my roommates. Like, you develop those relationships, and it's kind of hard to sever ties with that, for guys that you literally go on the world with on the football field. So that was tough. And then especially, like, Penn State is still, like, Midwest, so the culture from, like, what I've seen in comparison to where I'm from is, like, similar but different. I went down to Baton Rouge, and it was, like, just totally different, man. Like, I think I lost 10 pounds my first practice. It was, like, steaming hot. I remember getting in the huddle, and I hadn't thought about, like, they have, like, some of them have really thick accents and stuff like that. Like, I literally, for some of my teammates, couldn't understand. Like, it was just, like, a language thing. This culture, I just wasn't used to, and being thrown into it, like, just as the guy from Detroit, that was just more adversity that I was just adding to what I hadn't dealt with. So then it all just kind of, then I had another injury. I tore my ACL. And at that point, like, that's why I say my career is, like, just kind of all over the place, only because it was just a lot to deal with. But yeah, those are always tough, but I would just say, like, and what I know, those relationships that were there, I could have leaned in a little bit more and dove into those, even if I did make the transition, like, going from Penn to LSU, even though it's a new environment, like, they know the situation, they know what's going on. You still have to talk about these things with somebody and get a little bit uncomfortable, but I think that's where my biggest lesson was, with just being able to voice that.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's tough, right? Because to your point, you were highly touted growing up, right? And you're going to all these things. You get offered to your first camp. And so, I mean, everything is going so well for so long, right? And then you, boom, you hit your first adversity, and then it sort of hits two adversities, three, four, five, right? And you never took care of one or figured out how to handle one, and now you're at five, and you're like, I don't know where to go. And I think about it today with the more, I guess there's just more transferring, for lack of a better way to say it. You know, and I look at somebody like, the one who always pops in my head is somebody like Spencer Rattler, right? Similar. Like, I mean, highly touted over and over and over again, right? And put up on the big stage and, you know, just didn't really work out at Oklahoma. But you then transfer to South Carolina. Like, I don't know. It doesn't ever seem like he's someone who maybe has reached out for that help as well at times. And so I think it's a good lesson to hear somebody like yourself, you know, talk about you wish you had. Because I think there's more guys who are doing the transfer because location seems like it's going to change things for them. But to your point, haven't maybe taken care of the root of just dealing with adversity.
Yeah, that's really the key. And I know if that had been dealt with, like, I was the same person. Like, nothing had changed.
Yeah.
It was just the inside of me, like, my confidence was shaken. So I know if that would have been dealt with properly, and Rob could have, like, come into LSU, like, with my chest out like I did at Penn.
Yeah.
Things would be a little bit different. Like, and this is speculation, of course, but, like, you just know, like, if I'm the same kid going into these situations and I just want to play ball, that changes things. But you really have to deal with it. At the onset of it.
Yeah.
Just not let it linger.
Well, that's why I think, you know, on the other side of the coin, I always look at Jalen Hurts, right? Like, Jalen stuck it out and sort of, I bet you, worked on a lot of those things. And then he gets to the NFL, right? And he's put down literally every game, overanalyzed. He's beat up on the media, whatever it is. And now look at him. But this is a guy who's built his whole career on overcoming adversity, right?
Yeah.
So it's like the opposite side where it's all he probably knew from really early on in his time in Alabama, and now he's able to be successful because he's had the experience.
Yeah, that's 100% right. And it just works out. It's funny how it works out differently for each person.
Yeah.
But I think that's what makes it cool. That's what makes sports cool. The fact that we all have those stories and we can all share those stories. Like, I know there are times where I'm the guy that I have to touch the stove, but if there's a way not to, if you can give me the wisdom and understanding not to be able to, like, I'd rather do that.
Yeah.
But sometimes we just self-sabotage, man. Like, I think now people are more receptive to that information, and this is the information age. Like, everything is online, everything is accessible. Everybody's pushing you to like the mental health thing. Like, all of these things are, like, out there, so there really is no excuse for not reaching out, really, especially if you do know that could be something that's holding you back. So that's a great example.
Yeah.
Jalen, he definitely stuck it out, did his thing, and just took advantage of every opportunity.
Yeah, he really did. But, well, and that's why hopefully we're doing, you know, this is why this podcast exists, right? It's an opportunity for hopefully others to hear what you went through, not touch the stove, and instead just raise your hand and say, hey, look, I know I can get here, but I need to get help getting through this. And, you know, if you help one kid, that's what this is worth it. So,
100%. Yep.
So you go to LSU, the injury happens, you end up at Eastern Michigan. Talk a little bit about that, and then at this stage you're thinking about the NFL. Talk through what that was all like for you.
Yeah, so toward the end of my career at LSU, we got a new position coach, which was unfortunate for me because I was injured at the time and had no way of being on the field. So as I'm recovering from ACL surgery, we get the idea that since I'm 6'4", 220 at this point, I could go out and play receiver. So this was the first change of position, which was an advantage to me because, like, I could play the position easily, really, because I had the size, I could catch, and I knew the offense from a quarterback's perspective. So that was a fun spring. Like, I did really well at receiver. I enjoyed it. And at the end of that, only in the spring was when I kind of just wanted to get back to quarterback. So here we go again. Like, I'm looking at different schools and all of this stuff. And I ended up finding a spot back home, coming back to Eastern Michigan. And that whole project, this was a I had never in my life been on a team that, like, didn't win. So this was just another piece of adversity going to a school that's not popular for winning. Like, it was a losing team at the time. They're doing great now, like in bowl games and stuff, but at the time we weren't. That just wasn't Eastern. So that was a thing. So it's just it was just a lot of different stuff, man, that I had to deal with during this time. Just kind of chasing the perfect opportunity when I probably could have just made these opportunities perfect just by sticking it out, just by making a few tweaks within myself, having a conversation, whatever it may have been. All three different schools had very distinct lessons attached to them.
Yeah.
All of which I would say, like, now that I've been out for so long, they definitely have helped to just shape how I view things, shape how I know the world works, and really gave me insight into myself, like how I deal with stuff, how I deal with adversity, and how I decided to at that time in comparison to how I would want to do it in the future, because the situations are the same. It's just the difference being I don't have to, like, be on the field. Like, you're gonna get hit in the mouth outside of the field. Like, I'm talking about getting engaged. Like, you're talking about being a leader and having to lead a family. Like, you're still the quarterback. So,
yep.
Like, you still have to deal with all of this stuff that maybe you haven't dealt with. I've dealt with all of those things. I feel back in that space where I can walk around with my chest out in a sense. Knowing that, like, I feel good now. Like, I've had those experiences and they've shaped who I am to go forward and be confident in what it is that I'm doing.
Yeah. You're right. I mean, we talked about this. I'm a new father, 10-week-old son at the time of the recording of this. I mean, and I didn't play college sports, but I had my own kind of – I was one of the student loan situations, like, but there's countless times throughout life, like, I'm hitting the mouth over and over again. Like, let me tell you how many times I was hitting the mouth the first week my son was born. I mean, he's sleeping for 30 minutes at best. I mean, you're getting hit in the mouth like you've never seen.
Yeah.
So I think it's a good analogy that, like, life is going to continue hit you in the mouth over and over again. And some of them are blindsides. Like, you just never even saw it coming. Some of them you can see coming, but you just don't know how to step out of the way. But the important thing, and what I'm hearing from what you're saying, is you've got to step back at some point and look back and try to learn something from it. Even if you didn't at the moment, you can turn what was maybe a failure or situation in your life you're not proud of or happy about into a positive going forward for the rest of your life. And that's probably the best thing you can do.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's so needed because we don't know why we're going through, the things that we're going through at the moment. But there's a quote, and I pray that I don't butcher it, but it says, I think, and I'm paraphrasing, that life is lived in the present but understood in the future. So like 5 or 10 years later, however far removed you are from those situations, is the only time that you can reflect. Like at the moment where you're in it, it sucks. Like it doesn't feel good. Refinement never feels good in the moment. Going back to Little League, it never felt good when my dad had me running extra sprints and all of this stuff. Yeah. But looking back now, it's like, oh, I get it. He was attempting to instill this type of character, this type of response to adversity, like all of these things. You don't get it in the moment, but you always can look back and use those moments to shape who you are. And ultimately, they do make who you are.
Right. Yeah, and you can decide whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, but they're gonna turn you into someone. So it's up to you. So I think it's a great lesson. So you end your time at Eastern, and like you said, you made the effort towards the NFL. So like, what was that experience like?
Yeah, at this point, I was just not in the greatest mental spot, but for preparing for that time, I was still going at it. Like, I was still attempting to put myself in position, but in the back of my mind, I'm like, I don't really know if this is going to work. And I'm just being completely honest. Like, when I got the opportunity, the short time that I got, I was with the Lions. I wasn't on, like, the practice squad or anything like that. This was literally just, like, me going and just showing my face, trying. And even that experience, man, at that point, I just knew, like, okay, I love this game. I've been in it for a while. Like, this is not – it didn't have that same fun feeling that it once had. And that was only because I had just been just beat up and kind of just – I don't know. The process had gotten to me at that point, to where I'm like, I'm just trying to figure out what's next.
Yeah.
And I know that even if I do get in this league, it doesn't last long. So like, okay, even if I get in, I'm now thinking like, all right, I'll have maybe a couple $100,000, and then like it just started becoming like, what is this next chapter for Rob gonna be? Not so much I'm about to just be in a league and try to stay here and just be here. So the narrative started to shift a little bit for me, and the process was enjoyable. I enjoyed every step of it, man. I built my body up like crazy and was like just performing just ridiculous numbers. But that was the full extent of my NFL career. Nothing more than that at all. And from there, it was like, okay, like, and I probably could have, I had calls for like indoor or arena, stuff like that. But I just didn't have an interest for it at that point. And that's when I kind of got into doing the finance thing. That's when I was introduced to it and decided to make that transition towards it.
Yeah, so I mean, talk about that. Why? Like, what about it? How did you get approached? Like, talk about... You already started to think about what's next, which I think is the toughest part for a lot of people, but you had already started to kind of come to grips with that. But then why did you get into this? What interested you about finance and insurance originally? And talk about that.
Yeah, so during this time, I'm still trying to figure out, okay, what is this thing that I'm about to do next? I feel like all athletes can attest to it. It's like a year or two where you're literally just like, what is life after this sport? And I took a couple odd jobs. I found a job that I enjoyed enough to stay for a few years. I did that. And in the midst of that, I was introduced to a guy by my father. His name is John. And John got me in the finance industry. I started in insurance, and I ended up getting an insurance license. Over time, I ended up getting, like, it was called a Series 6 and 63. It allows you to sell, like, mutual funds and different investments and stuff. And during this time, I just had a taking to it just because it allowed me, in a sense, to, like I mentioned earlier, I was still kind of quiet. This kind of forced me to come out of my shell and expand my personality and interact with people and deal with people and to actually listen to people.
Yeah.
So with that, I appreciated it, and I liked that aspect just because I could see a little bit of growth coming out of me. And then I started to take it serious as I became very, very inquisitive, and I would ask questions, and I would talk to people that I was dealing with and seek other advisors and seeing what they were doing. And over time, it's been close to 6 years since I've been in. Over time, I just start talking to more and more people, getting more and more licensing, and just developing the idea of what I wanted the industry to provide for myself. And as I was with the firm, it worked out for the time that I was there. And then as I started getting more ideas,
yeah,
we started kind of butting heads a little bit, only because, like, at the time I thought it was absurd, but now in the future I look back knowing that this is just the way that they're legally structured and they can't allow it. So I understand, but I had ideas to want to deal with, like, former athletes and, like, go back to schools and do programs and teach financial literacy and all of these different things. And that's where I kind of came up with the idea of the Money QB. I have to give my fiance credit for that. She's the one that termed it. But I wanted to, like, put that in schools and start teaching kids about, you know, how they can start dealing with their money so that they don't go into these colleges and do the same things that I did. And that became a issue for the firm. Of course, you got to do what's called an OBA and submit everything that you do with them. And as I submitted it, a long time ago. They never got back to me until, like, I was finished working on everything conveniently.
Yeah.
And told me I had to, like, squash it all. And basically told me that I needed to either get rid of what I was doing and stick with the firm, or just leave. And I chose to do the latter, and that's what got the Money QB going, where I'm now my own RIA and able to do things where I don't have to, like, look over my shoulder anymore. So it's cool in that aspect. But yeah, even my experience in the industry has been in a lot of different places, giving me a lot of insight to different people and how things are done. And I'm grateful for that experience, because now I understand the full context of, like, what it is to do financial planning, and even the way that it's tied into what I did with, like, planning on the football field.
Mm-hmm.
It's a direct correlation when you think about it. Like, game planning a football game is very meticulous. And the way that I go about doing it now, like, you have a playbook, you have, like, formations, you have different things that you can do and technicalities that you can call on when you are in a particular situation. So it's the same type. We're speaking the same language.
Yep.
And I enjoy it because, like, now I'm attempting to have my firm to be former athletes, people who do speak that language too. So, for example, like, I use my first meeting as a huddle up. It's all the same type stuff, which makes it a lot of fun. And essentially, like I said earlier, the Money QB is all about doing the same things that we were doing on the football field, but just off the field now. It's the same type of thing. So, yeah, it's been a really cool experience.
Yeah, and I mean, I would imagine, again, some of the things that maybe you didn't deal with during your playing career, like you said, not being vulnerable enough to ask for help, you know, the adversity that you were facing, maybe not sticking with it and trying to overcome it where you were. I mean, for a lot of people, money is the most vulnerable topic in their lives, right? Mm-hmm. And a lot of people deal with a lot of adversity related to money. And they don't raise their hand for help. So I sort of view what your experience was, and because you didn't do some of those things and you've now realized that over time, is probably driving you in what you're doing now, because whether they're former athletes or not, money is everybody's game that they're trying to work through, right?
Yeah, you're 100% right. And yeah, it's just really interesting because, like you said, whether they are an athlete or not, like, people recognize that this is a thing. And if they don't know sports at all, they typically know who the quarterback is. So yeah, you're spot on with that. I would agree 100%.
Yeah, it's like you said, it's what I love about what we do. You know, me being specifically focused on football players. You know, yeah, I want to make it as relatable as possible to what they know. And it really is. I mean, the most successful people with money have the same traits as the most successful people on the football field, right? Disciplined, willing to overcome adversity, willing to take risks that they're, you know, that they feel comfortable with and confident in. They're willing to hire people to coach them, right? They're willing to put in the hours to train. All of those same traits transfer to being successful with money. And if you can just figure out, and you know, I think we're both trying to do that, how to take all those wonderful traits that made you an amazing athlete and just transition them over to money in whatever business or multiple businesses you want to have after playing. And if you can do that, you're going to be more successful than most regular people because you have a certain level of skill set that regular people don't have. And if you can be the way you are and look back on your career and think about the adversity that you've overcome, overcoming money adversity looks a lot easier than, hey, I played in front of 100,000 people in my first year at 18 years old. Yeah. And then by the time I'm 22, my career looks so different than that first day I stepped off that bus.
Yeah,
you know, to me, like, that is more, you know, can be more soul self-esteem crushing than some of the money issues even I dealt with student loans, because I wasn't on that mountain at the beginning of my time. Right.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, your story is really a great one to hear, whether, again, you're on the field or you're off of it dealing with money and life. Because whether you start at the mountain and you come down, or you're at the bottom and you're trying to make it up, there's adversity you're going to hit at all points.
Yeah, in either direction. You just have to be ready for it and just know that no matter how beautiful it looks today, there's always tomorrow. And I just try to train myself to realize that with everything or with nothing, you have to be content. Like, you just have to know, like, hey, like, I'm here, this is the situation, and whatever comes at me, I know that just looking at the history, if we're looking at the data, if we're talking financial terms, looking at the historical data, I've overcome everything that I've been through as of today. The likelihood that I'll be able to do that in the future is very likely. So I'm not going to beat myself up. I'm not going to, like, get down about it. It is what it is. You pick up the pieces where they are, and you are able to move forward from that. So, it definitely takes a lot to process those things, because we, as just being humans, like, at adversity or those trying times can naturally just bring you down, but it doesn't have to. We just train ourselves. It's just like building a muscle, going to the gym. Like, you don't get that muscle just by going on Tuesday at 6 a.m. Like, you have to keep doing it and practicing and getting those reps. And then the further along that you do that, and the more reps that you get, your foundation is set. You shouldn't have to rebuild that at all. You should be solid.
Yeah. And I also take from your story, you know, you brought up the very beginning, relationships, right? And as an athlete, we're used to having coaches our whole lives, right? Mm-hmm. you know, the other big thing, you know, whether it's transitioning a life after football or it's as you're going along in a business, you know, you've talked about your career, some changes after football. You've gone through these transitions as well. Leaning on other people around you, whether it's literally a coach or it's a trainer or it's, to your point, you've reached out to peers, you've gone to conferences, you know, you're trying to learn as much as you can all the time, just like a football player. You're trying to learn, you know, watching game film, you know, talking to your coaches. So it's leveraging the relationships and finding people who can be coaches in life after football, to me, also is a lesson from your story. And in those relationships, whatever they are so important to continue and find throughout the rest of your life.
Yeah, that's 100% fact. And if I ever, I typically never tell people, people ask me, like, would you change anything? My answer typically is no, because everything happened the way that it was supposed to. But what I will say, one skill set that I wish I had at that time was being able to cultivate those things. Because if you really think about it, that time in college is a gold mine for a kid. To be at a Penn State in that position and having the ears of basically an entire town, an entire Midwest, entire country, if you're on that stature, that position can be very, very powerful. And the amount of people that you can put on or help or like bring along, as well as utilize other people's resources, like this is where I wasn't necessarily mature enough to realize that I had a lot more to experience and a lot more to give in that aspect if I had focused on the people around me. Because a lot of them now, like some of them I still talk to, some of them not, but like you, if you just continue to do it throughout college, it's not like you have to rekindle the flame after college or something like that. Just keep it going. And that's not for like selfish gain or anything. Just genuinely be interested in people is what I'm saying. And that will go way further than you could ever imagine.
Yeah, rising tides lift all boats, right? You know, being there for other people will eventually help you in some way, shape, or form. Yeah. It's either in that moment, it's in the future, we don't know, but continuing to be there for the right people, right? And making sure that you are continuing to surround yourself with the right people throughout life is extremely important. So, I mean, man, this has been a great conversation. I've loved hearing more about the journeys. I didn't know nearly as many details as you shared, but are there any parting ideas, stories, lessons we haven't talked about that you want people to know?
Man, I think we covered a lot from A to Z. My story has been one of a lot of joy, all of the experience, all of the emotions you can think of is a story of myself. But yeah, man, I would just say for anybody that is listening, for anybody that is in the midst of that, being in school, being like on the field and going through some of the things that we are talking about right now, I would just say, man, really just focus on that moment. I know we have ideas of what the future will look like and planning out 5 years from now and I'm going to be doing X, Y, and Z. All of that is great, and I know it's kind of paradoxical that I'm saying this as a financial planner where we map out the next whatever years, but like in the space that you may be in right now, like that's the best place that you can be. Like really just take that in and understand that moment and where you are, because you don't get to run out of the tunnel again once you're done. You don't get to step off of the bus for the first time when you're done. You don't get those moments. So really just be present in those and appreciate them for what they are. Because like I said, all that you have afterwards is your recollection of those moments, and that's, you'll talk about them, you'll share your stories about them, and you'll be able to talk, like, you want those to be ones that you thoroughly, like, enjoy. And if you left anything on the table, you also will have to live with that and deal with that in your own way. So that would be my advice. Just really, really soak up that time, because being on that campus in that situation is very special, and you won't realize that until it's over.
I mean, that's life, man. I mean, being present. One, I think, for me personally, I think for a lot of men, I would say this too. Being present is one of the most difficult things in all areas of life, right? I mean, I've got a 10-week-old baby. I'm building a business. Yeah, it's tough to be present in both situations at sometimes, but you're right. Like, what you do today 100% shapes your future. So you can worry all you want about the future, but if you're not worried about what you're doing today, you're not going to build the future you want. In all areas of life. So
yeah, that's 100%, man. That's really all it's about. And there's nothing wrong with planning. I don't want to say, like,
that's our job.
Don't think about the future at all. So do that, but there should be a balance of everything. Doing too much of something can always result in a little bit of harm. So be balanced about it. Look ahead, but don't take it that, or don't put too much emphasis on the future where you just forget about where you are today.
Yeah, man. Yeah, because I that story of you stepping off the bus, like, I mean, that's going to stick in my mind. Like, I mean, I can only picture it, let alone imagine what it was like in that moment. And to your point, that happens once. Mm-hmm. And that hadn't happened for a person for, you know, 90 years. When you did it,
right.
100 years almost, right? And so that's unbelievable when you think about it in that context. And it's like, if you could just bottle that up and relive it over and over again, you would.
Right.
Right? So.
Actually, it's very cool, man. And I actually have, like, a video of it. Every now and then I meet people. They're like, oh, you were the quarterback. You can show them the video and stuff like that. But yeah, you're spot on. It's really cool to be present in those things and experience those things. But you just want to take full advantage of them whenever you can.
Yeah. Well, Rob, I really appreciate, you know, you talking about your journey, your life. I think there's a lot of great lessons in here for guys about to be in college, currently in college, after college, where they're in the pros now, transitioning out of being, you know, in the NFL. I think there's a lot of great lessons from your journey for people to take. So thanks for taking the time and really appreciate it.
Yeah, absolutely. Happy to do it anytime, man. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.